good afternoon, everybody. I think there are many clinicians in this room. I wonder how many of you do see suicidal patients actually. Could you raise your hand? Quite much. Yeah. Since we have only 12 minutes, I start to improvise. And okay, can you hear me now? And you know, first of all, the most eastern region where suicide is the biggest is such a big problem is Nikkeri. And region 6 and Nikkeri district have a lot of connection. Many Guyanese people live in Nikkeri, in the Nikkeri area. You see here some numbers. These are actual numbers. So you can see that people below the 15 years old seldom die by suicide. But there's a steep rise in adolescence. And the number of attempts is rising even faster. So what we of course try to do is to intervene as early as possible before it becomes dangerous. Now, when I was a student, a master's student, I did my internship in Groningen, not Suriname, but in the Netherlands. And I remember that on a Tuesday evening, I was only a couple of weeks there, there was a young girl, she was almost 19 years old, and I was on duty, and she said, I'm thinking about committing suicide. I felt it here everywhere. And the best thing I thought I could do was call her back and say, come back Thursday. In the meantime, I could think. There was no gatekeeper training yet. Suicidology, like we have now, the study of suicide and all its aspects, it's a very complicated matter, wasn't there at the time. That was in the 70s. So the best thing I thought I could do was call my supervisor, and I did. The girl came back, and I called my supervisor, and she laughed at the telephone. I even remember now. She said, oh, this is all countertransference. I said, what? This is all countertransference. And she explained what happened to me. She spoke about my fear of guilt, about being incompetent and things like that. But you know what you have to do, she said. Talk with her about it. I said, what? But I did. So when she came back on Thursday, I asked her, how do you feel about the fact that I asked you to come back within 2 days? I saw you were nervous, she said, but I liked it. I felt I mattered. To matter is an important aspect. The feeling that you don't matter is a risk factor. So there I learned a lot. And for many patients later, I learned a lot of things. I remember a patient, for example. That was in a Nikkeri hospital. You know, I worked some 17 years just opposite of this river here, in the Nikkeri District Hospital. I've never been here in New Amsterdam, and I'm very happy to be here. But many people from this region have family there and cross the river back and forth. Now, this lady I was thinking about came from this region, but lived for years already. Or with her husband and 4 children in Nikkeri, one of the remote areas where suicide is a major problem. In the center of Nikkeri, suicide is not that problem. But in remote areas live the people with most psychiatric problems, most poverty, most alcoholic problems, and things like that. She lived there. I came into contact with her because her husband did a suicide attempt by ingesting paraquat. Paraquat, Gramaxone. Dr. Adu spoke about it, about locked boxes, about which we know so much a lot by now, about the effects of using locked boxes. I'll come to that later. But her husband was in the hospital. He was not dead at the time. He lived, and I visited him. And later I saw his wife at the entrance of the hospital. And I said to her, how do you feel? I hope he will die. So I said, what happened? And she said, I was abused for years. And that's one of the main things, being abused and families keeping that secret. So many families keep and kept that secret. I know that in the first years when I worked in Nikeri, from 2000 on, it was impossible to say that this was a major problem in Hindustani families. Not so much in Creole families, but especially in Hindustani families. Now, everybody in Nikeri and everybody in Suriname speaks about it, even international. It reigns also among Hindustani people from Hindustani descent, also in Guyana, also in Trinidad, also in India, everywhere. Why is that? So it's very important to study this matter. And we did and we do, and I'll come to that a little bit later. But first, about that lady. What happened there? There were a lot of problems. There were relational problems. Most of them. Let's move to the next slide. Yeah, when asked for motives, for example, most people report relational problems, but I know that many problems are kept secret for two reasons. One, because there's a family code. You don't speak about things out of the family. And second, religion prohibits to think about suicide, because it's only God, who has the right to decide about the end of your life. So people feel guilty about it and don't discuss it. And not only religions, the major religions prohibit thinking and acting on suicidal ideas, but only in many countries there was a law. In Suriname, dying by suicide is not a criminal offense anymore. I don't know exactly how that is in Guyana, to be honest. I forgot about it. Is criminal still a criminal act? Yeah. So that helps, between brackets, for people not to speak about it. Still, we clinicians and everybody in this room is there for this reason. We want to know what are the risk factors, what are the factors that bring people to the edge of wanting to die. Now, what I learned over the years, that is most people do not want to die. They want to end a most painful situation. And dying seems to be the only solution that is there. I learned it from this woman, for example, because she told me she went to the police so often. But her husband had friends with the police, so they didn't do anything. So this went on and went on and went on. And she said, you know what, since she became more open in this talk, she said, if he's not going to die, I commit suicide. I cannot stand this any longer, being abused. Now, in thinking about suicide, there historically and at this moment, sometimes we can feel some empathy and understanding of people who die by suicide because of these painful situation. But there are also adolescents, for example, who threaten to die by suicide because they don't get the shoes they want. And I even remember one adolescent boy of 16-year-old who stepped out of a corral, a boat, and the girl he considered to be his girlfriend did not laugh to him, but to another boy. He did a suicide attempt to hurt her and to say, I'm your boy. Later understood that she didn't know he was interested, so from her side there was nothing on. But for him it was very important. But in most cases there are two things. In a mental state, hopelessness, despair, as in this woman and in the girl of 18 years old. Painful and hopelessness, mental pain and hopelessness are two of the main risk factors you can discern. So what did we do? we try to develop programs with that intervene in adolescence, because there the problem starts, or even before adolescence, in learning children to speak about emotions, for example, or speak about social relations, or to have some empathy with other children, so that they, that in the hope that they deal with also with depressive effects and other feelings, and that might prevent them to commit suicide. And what we learned also that is in, that in speaking about suicidal ideas, I was afraid that she, that I would make a mistake and she would die through my mistake. That was about a girl, the adolescent girl. But I learned over the years that speaking about suicidal ideation, it doesn't bring this adolescent or this adult in more danger. On the contrary, it helps and it lowers the danger. So we have wonderful research about this, and always it underscores the fact that speaking about suicidal ideations help. Now, let's move to screening for a couple of minutes. Screening. Go on. More. Yes, yes. Now, we have to do a lot of things because this suicidality is a complex problem. It needs a public health aspect. It needs all kinds of matters. It needs preventive approaches. And luckily, Guyana has a wonderful national strategy. And I hope you know that. But we have to approach the problem from many sides. And a lot of colleagues, and Ishtar will speak about it, you spoke about it. We try to attack all the risk factors, and one of the measures is to screen adolescents as soon as possible before they go over to the last dangerous phase and take the step to ingest, for example, Gramaxone. Now, normally, a screening project, we developed one in Nikiri, a screening project had two phases. The first phase is putting a questionnaire in front of the adolescent and ask a lot of questions. For example, do you think sometimes life is worthless? Do you think about dying? Things like that. So questions about suicide and suicide ideation. The second phase is an assessment phase. A clinician, a counselor, speaks with the person, and especially in instances where the person scores high above a certain point on that scale. So screening is in fact a two-phase process, the protocol phase and a clinical interview. For doing such a clinical interview, you have to be trained. And therefore we need gatekeeper training. And we know also that gatekeeper training, you can learn, the counselors can learn it, you have to have the courage to do it, but you can learn it. And not only counselors should learn it, but also medical doctors, general practitioners should learn it. One of the projects we do in Suriname is assisting general practitioners to learn to speak with their patients, because they are not the best persons to speak with patients because they have no time. For the last minute, what these programs are done in several countries, many countries. So what we do is not new. But we know, for example, that locked boxes do not work that well. We know also that screening projects do not work that well. We need more. And the thing we learn most, and that is to shorten it, of course, the thing we learn most is you have to develop a comprehensive program with a lot of areas to be directed to. You need funding, you need training, you need people who will do the work, and we, last but not least, we need a lot of research. I hope it was interesting to you. It was a pleasure to speak.